Good morning. Welcome to EduSite Network. Friend, you know, this week we have organized a series of lectures on English literature. And today we are moving further from the last lecture in that we discussed the modern English literature. We will try to understand today, in today's lecture, the outline of postmodern English literature and its salient feature. And for discussion on this very topic, we have in studio senior academician Dr. Bhim Singh Dahiya. He is a true academician and he has also held several important positions in different organizations, and including the Vice Chancellor of Kurukshetra University. And Dr. Dahiya is a voracious reader, keep contemplating on different issues and keep writing on the several issues, especially on the literature. And he has written a number of books. The one book is very popular among a student is A New History of English Literature. So I think his knowledge and experience will help us to understand the postmodern English literature and will give insight how to study this period literature. So on your behalf, I welcome him for the EduSite lecture on this very topic. Welcome, sir.
Thank you. Well, as I said in the earlier lecture, every literary movement has behind it some big historical event as well as a set of radical ideas which are philosophic, psychological, economic, and so on. Behind this literary movement called postmodern, it is also called in the third world countries like India, post-colonial, because after independence, where colonies of the British, French, and these Spanish colonies were liberated. So these liberated countries, they would call it post-colonial. In the West, it is called post-modern. In history, it is also called post-industrial, so on and so forth. So there are several names to the later 20th century period. In literature, we generally call it post-modern period. Now, the big event behind it, the historical event, I mean, was the Second World War. Because Second World War disenchanted the Western world much more than was done by the first, because it was for the first time in World War II that atom bomb was used, and one bomb wiping out the whole city in Japan. Now that was a shock to the people, what kind of world we are living in. And they lost faith completely. The losing of faith had started with World War I, but in World War II, a complete loss of faith in the humanist philosophy, which had dominated the West right from the 15th century Renaissance, because Renaissance thought brought in the ideas of liberty, freedom, democracy, and science, scientific thinking. Now, man-centered philosophy was called humanism. Now, people thought, what use is humanism if this is what we are heading for? After 400 years of humanism, if there is wiping out of world population, then what kind of philosophy it is? So they lost faith. So it is a period of total disillusionment. In fact, nihilism. Nietzsche became more popular because Nietzsche gave that philosophy of death of God. And after death of God, there is no sharing of values among people, no community life, not even family life, and each individual stands alone by herself or by himself. And therefore, he substituted faith by perspective. Now, every individual is guided by her or his perspective rather than a shared faith, a set of beliefs, religious or moral. Now, this was a big change after World War II, and Nietzsche became a very dominant thinker for this period. Now, similarly, there were other thinkers who had influence in making the attitudes of the later 20th century people. One of them was, this time, by the way, the entire thought is coming from France in the 20th century. Earlier, of course, 19th century was dominated by the Germans, German philosophy of idealism and so on. Now it is the 20th century dominance by the French. Now the French thinker I was going to talk about is Lyotard, L-Y-O-T-A-R-D. In French, last syllable is not pronounced. D will not be pronounced. So they call it Lyotard. So Lyotard wrote a famous book called The Postmodern Condition, which came out in 1979. And in that book, among other things, he emphasized that truth is neither absolute nor self-contained. Because the Greek philosophy, which dominated the Western world over 2,000 years from Socrates, Plato, Aristotle, they had given the West the concept of reason and logic. And anything proved by reason and logic was considered as absolute truth. Now, Lyotard said, no, there is no such thing as absolute truth, nor is truth self-contained. It is related to so many other things. We may call them truths. And nothing is absolute. So this gave a shaking to the entire set of beliefs in the West. Now, similarly, another. And as he said, now nobody asks you what is the truth. In the later 20th century, after World War II, dominance of business comes. And people would rather ask you, what is the use? Why should I do it? So they will look for use rather than the truth, absolute truth. So utility, usefulness, that is why you have the dominance of technology. Not basic sciences, but applied sciences. And applied science is because we care for utility, usefulness of everything, including education. In literature, for example, now there are questions, why read poetry? Why read fiction? What is the use? And therefore, to keep their jobs, to make it look useful, language teachers, literature teachers took to communication skills, so that it can be useful in business world, in the corporate world. You give skills to present yourself, to present your ideas, to present your reports, so on and so forth. So communication skills is a part of that utilitarian attitude. This was a big change, and that came about because of this shock of World War II and certain ideas like Nietzsche, like Lyotard. Another French philosopher in the same period was Baudrillard, B-A-U-D-R-I-L-L-A-R-D. Again, D will be silent. So we pronounce it Baudrillard, and he is known for the philosophy of simulation. He said, now what is reality is no way to know except what you get through the electronic media. You are always switching on your TV, you are glued with the channels. And whatever reality is created on the screen, that is the reality. Not the reality in the street, but reality on the screen. So this is called simulation. And you see, Baudrillard wrote a famous article when the Gulf War began in 1991. he wrote an essay called Did the Gulf War Take Place? He said, how do we know? We only know what the America-controlled media all over the world presented. So reality, we do not know. We know only what is reported, you see, on the TV. So he gave this philosophy, and that also made a change, because the novelists, the poets writing in this period, they are also not going to the people to know the reality. They are basing our own writers like Salman Rushdie or Vikram Seth, so on and so forth. They are people of this period and writing depending upon these very things. They are sitting in America, England, Australia, and writing about India. They are not living in India. They are not living among people, but they are writing about it. So simulation replaced actual reality on the ground. Now you don't need to go to the ground, you just go to the media and you would know whatever truth they sell. It is also business. So you don't really know how much of it is true and how much of it is not. He was another. Then came many more French writers, thinkers. The ones who have had influence on literature, the most important name is Roland Barthes, R-O-L-A-N-D, D again is silent, Roland Barthes, B-A-R-T-H-E-S. So Roland Barthes wrote a famous article in 1968. The title was Death of the Author. He says there is no such thing as author. When you are reading Shakespeare or Milton or Wordsworth, don't try to know what Milton said or what Shakespeare said or what Wordsworth said. You look to the text, and text is nothing but a structure of words, and therefore attend to the structure. How does the structure work? What do the words mean, sentences mean? So it's a question of interpretation. So death of the author had its implications. Then he says it gives the reader freedom to interpret the way you like. Of course, I would not agree, because if the author is not there, what is that text? There is another literary critic in America called E.D. Hirsch, H-I-R-S-C-H, Hirsch. Now, he, like me, questions this death of the theory, sorry, death of the author concept. He says, what is a text then? What is a sentence or a paragraph? Can the words arrange themselves in a paragraph or in a poem or in a sentence? After all, somebody did it. If somebody did it, that person's character, his thoughts, his message, whatever he wants to communicate, has gone into it. So how do you say author is dead or author is irrelevant? Author is not irrelevant. Author is the most relevant factor. And it is not wrong to look for the authorial intention. You see, much before Roland Barthes, in 1930s, the New Critics, it was a school of criticism in America. In the New Critics, they had also written two famous articles, combined by William Wimsett, is also a historian of English literature, one of the historians. William Wimsett and Monroe Beardsley. Now, these two critics together wrote two essays. One was The Intentional Fallacy, and the other was Affective Fallacy. Intentional Fallacy saying the same thing, that do not look for the intention of the author. If you are looking for that, then it is fallacious exercise, it is false exercise. Similarly, in the theater, don't look for how people, the audience, were affected by a play. Some people may be weeping, some may be laughing. He says you can't have a uniform response among people to this. So looking for effect of a play is also fallacious. So this was their second article, the affective fallacy. So similarly, Roland Barthes declaring death of the author says it is fallacious to look for the author or his intention and so on. And then came another French writer or thinker, so many. This time it is Michel Foucault. And Foucault wrote, among many books, two important books which had influence on literature and literary thinking, literary criticism. One was History of Sexuality. And the other was Knowledge Power, with a slash in between. Now, in these two books, in History of Sexuality, he says what we generally believe, what is a man and what is a woman, he says these are not absolutes. These are not natural either. They vary from community to community, from nation to nation, from age to age. And it is the general discourse, the dominant discourse of a people in a particular age that constitutes this belief, what is man and what is woman. He says what we say woman today was constructed by the Victorian discourse, what people thought in the age of Victoria. And that formulated, yes, that is how a woman should be, and that's how a man should be. He says this is not universal, nor it is absolute, nor it is for everybody in every age. It changes from place to place. It changes from age to age, from people to people. So this was Michel Foucault. And thereafter, we started believing that all these things are constructed by culture, and therefore no such thing as a universal truth. So general belief in universality, essentiality, naturalness, on which depended what we call humanism, now they lost relevance, and people started disbelieving it. And they thought everything now, every belief is constructed and is also relative, because it changes from community to community. Tribals have one kind of culture, now Americans have another kind of culture. You cannot have or expect the same beliefs or values in the two people. So this was Michel Foucault in History of Sexuality. As for the other book, Knowledge Power, he said knowledge gives you power. And that is why when Europe colonized Asia and Africa, they first gathered knowledge about the people there living in Africa and Asia. If you remember, in India, the British brought a whole lot of scholars from England who were called the British Orientalists. So these Orientalists knew Sanskrit, and through their knowledge of Sanskrit, they read our ancient literature, Vedas and Shastras and other writings, literature of the ancient period, and they tried to understand the culture of the people. And through that understanding, they tried to govern the Indians, similarly other nations and other peoples. So Foucault gives this theory that knowledge leads to power. And around the same time in Italy came Gramsci. Now, Gramsci gave a theory of culture, and he said cultures also are like the various species. Some are more developed, some are less developed. And more developed cultures will always dominate the less developed culture. Just as this issue of Telangana and Andhra Pradesh, or Punjab, Haryana, or Uttarakhand, UP, Jharkhand, Bihar, so on and so forth. Because some areas are more developed, some communities or castes are more developed, they dominate, and therefore those that are not so developed, they react, they want a separate land, etc., etc. So similarly, Gramsci gave this theory of dominant cultures, and he said the colonization was not merely a military or a political activity. This was also through the dominance of culture. We still believe that anything comes coming from the West is superior. Englishmen doing or Americans doing, automatically we get influenced. We take it that they are superior people and whatever they are doing is true. And they are modern, we are not modern, we were made to believe. So these ideas dominate the literature of this period after World War II, second half of the 20th century. Then another, still another French writer or thinker, who in fact has been much more influential, is Derrida. Derrida gave a theory of De France. In fact, he has that famous book, among many more books, Writing and De France. Instead of difference, he uses the word A, I mean letter A, in place of E. So rather than difference, he calls it De France. And he says, I do it deliberately because in French, difference has two distinct meanings. So to combine both the meanings, I am changing the spellings to De France. And now those two meanings of De France are, one, to differ, and the other, to defer. So to differ means that every word has a different meaning from every other. Therefore, every object, everything has to be defined in terms of other things, not by itself, because it is not a self-contained truth. It is not absolute, it is relative. So a table is a table because it is not a chair. It is not a fan, so on and so forth. So negatively, through difference with other things, you have to define an object. Secondly, defer. He says meanings are not absolute. Meanings are not universal. Meanings are also relative. And meanings change from time to time, place to place, text to text, and therefore this again is also relative, and nobody can say that this is the only meaning or absolute meaning or universal meaning of a poem by Milton or a play by Shakespeare. It is tentative, because by the time you have written your interpretation, the next is ready. So this sort of instability, meanings are not stable, reality is not stable. So this idea was given by Derrida, and he is called deconstructionist because he gave the theory of deconstruction. He said, let us deconstruct the Western philosophy. Right from Greek or Roman to the present, he says, there is a clear binary thinking. in Western philosophy means you think through binaries like body and soul, life and death, heaven and hell, so on and so forth. And he says, whatever comes first is superior to whatever comes later. Man, woman, again, priority is man, priority is heaven, priority is good, priority is soul, priority is sky, not earth. So these hierarchical binaries, he says, this explains the thinking of the West, and therefore let us deconstruct it. Let us see what is behind it and why do we have this hierarchy. So this finally led to the present day literature and literature study to what we call decentering. So Derrida decentered our approach to literature and literary approach to reality. And that's why the question of margins came. The people who are oppressed, people who are denied justice, including women, poor, colonized, you see, now they should be brought in the center. So margins should be brought to center, and center should be now disbanded, replaced. Interestingly, one of the postmodern playwright in England, see, he wrote a play called Rosencrantz and Guildenstern Are Dead. Now, Rosencrantz and Guildenstern are minor characters in Shakespeare's Hamlet. Now, Hamlet is at the center. So, decentering and see what these minor characters say on the periphery. So that should also be given equal importance. That's why feminism, because women have been denied justice, equality, liberty for a long time, and they have been oppressed. So therefore, they would like to reinterpret literature and rewrite criticism from the viewpoint of women. Similarly, you have today a very strong movement called Dalit literature and Dalit poetics, because they want to study literature and life from the viewpoint of these people who have been denied justice and equality for centuries and how they have been oppressed. So now they want to reinterpret literature from their viewpoint. So all these ideas were thrown up in the later 20th century, and this changed the whole scenario. You have different kind of novel, different kind of poetry, different kind of drama, and different kind of thinking. So literary criticism also gets split. As the world got split, it is also a very strange phenomenon that on the one hand, we have globalization. The entire world has shrunk into a small village, as McLuhan said, Marshall McLuhan. But then, at the same time, there is more and more localization of communities. And they want to think in terms of their small groups. So literature also has split on the same lines. Literary criticism has split on the same lines. So globalization on the one hand and localization on the other, both these contradictory forces, they are working simultaneously in the postmodern world.
So they are the person who, in fact, gave kind of boundaries or kind of viewpoint under which we can understand what exactly the postmodern we mean.
Yes.
So the major characteristic one students take up the piece of writing from the linguist literature, and they need to find out if these criteria, these things meet up, then
yes,
this is the modern literature.
Yeah, that's how critically they should look into it. which of these ideas are being reflected by which of the texts? Because every poem, every novel, every play will reflect one or another of these ideas. Okay. And that has shaped our literature. Now, coming to literature partly, the larger influence, mm-hmm. I had said in the earlier lecture also that after World War I, the power center had started shifting to America. And after World War II, it completely shifted to America. The so-called globalization is nothing but what we call the unipolar world. Earlier, it was bipolar because USSR was one force. They were the Marxist countries, Eastern Europe and Western Europe, capitalist economy, including America, and the world was divided into two. But after the collapse of USSR, it became unipolar. So American dominance, now neoliberalism, which is another name for capitalism. Now that dominates the whole world so much so that even China has to follow the market economy. The communist world left is China. That country, very powerful, very large, literarily, population-wise, economically, and yet they cannot survive without following the market economy given by America or the capitalist world. So that is one implication of this. Similarly, even in literature, the center shifted to America. What we are seeing in British literature or Indian literature or African or Caribbean literature or even Canadian and Australian literature, all written in English. Now, this area of English literature has also enlarged after World War II. Earlier, before First World War, we used to study in MA just English literature. And then after that, it became Anglo-American.
Right.
So all those American writers were also included. And now after World War II, in the postmodern phenomenon, it is not English literature, it is literature in English. So Indian writers, Australian writers, African writers, now every writer we teach and include because they have equal right, they have equal voice.
Right. So, in terms of power, what we find that the polarization, bipolarization world has come to one polar, single polar world. But what about the in terms of ideas that exist or that also come to an end?
No. Ideas, as I said, these French writers.
Because the Marxist world is now following the capitalist market economy.
Capitalist. But then with capitalism are these ideas from France, these thinkers. Which have influenced the present-day literature and the entire psyche as a whole. This goes very well with capitalism because neoliberalism or market economy or capitalism, this also survives on the ideas of total freedom. Liberalism, that's why it is called, because they say there should be no government to dominate or to dictate. Government should only facilitate the freedom of the individual to innovate, to do whatever business one wants to do, and so on. That is why in America, the corporates have been, deciding the American politics, the American policies. Similarly, in India now, big business, it may be Ambani's or any other, now they dominate. And the policy makers have to look up to them. What should be the financial policy or other policies that we follow? So the corporates dominate now because they are the multinationals. They hold the strings of money, bags, and therefore political power. Now, all this has infiltrated into literature also. Let me explain through American literature again, how American literature now is leading after World War II, and British literature is secondary. Indian literature is secondary. We are only doing what they are doing. Now, in America, after World War II, immediately you have a whole crop of writers. I read them when I was in America doing my PhD. Now, one of the very first is Norman Mailer. He has a lot of novels. More famous among them is The Naked and the Dead. The Naked and the Dead is about World War II, and he exposes the unholy alliance in America between politics and business. So he is writing a new kind of historical novel, which is directly political. It is addressing the contemporary politics. But he is not writing in the old style of the Victorian novel. He is writing in the new journalistic style, like journalists do investigative journalism. So they are writing history, investigating into the events of contemporary history and making a novel out of it. So mixing history, journalism, personal biography, because he writes about himself also. Now these three factors combined, or components or constituents combined, make the contemporary novel. Similarly, on our side, if you read Salman Rushdie writing Midnight Children about a contemporary historical event, that was partition of India, 1947, and how those born, he himself was born the same night of 1947. So mixing his personal biography with historical event and investigating into it, he is again copying
Mailer.
Mailer, Norman Mailer,
yeah.
The Naked and the Dead.
Dead.
Similarly, Amitav Ghosh, writing historical novels, post-colonial,
mm-hmm.
How the opium trade during the British Raj, flourished and so on. And he worked for several years, he says, to look into the old history papers, archaeology, other writings to make this novel. Now, in America, there was another writer immediately after World War II, John Barth. And John Barth wrote a novel called The Sotweed Factor. Now, sotweed is another name for tobacco. So the tobacco factor, just like the opium factor.
Mm-hmm.
So what Amitav Ghosh is doing is nothing really but an imitation of what John Barth did in America, writing The Sotweed Factor.
Mm-hmm.
So we are writing similar kind of now novels which the Americans did. Now another writer of the same period, Kurt, K-U-R-T, Vonnegut, V-O-N-N-E-G-U-T, Junior. Now, he also wrote a lot of novels, Cat's Cradle and so on. But also with Cat's Cradle, by the way, is about the father of the atom bomb. So he imagined how this scientist must have passed his life, what kind of private life he had. So a sort of imaginary biography made of this father of the bomb, Cat's Cradle. He said, must be just playing Cat's Cradle like children on 10 fingers and so on. And he also wrote a novel about World War II, Slaughterhouse-5, about Nazi Germany, how Hitler, eliminated the Jews and so on. So Slaughterhouse Five. These writers directly gave the lead to all writing in English. It may be in England, it may be in India, it may be elsewhere. Now, John Barth had written two important articles. One was The Literature of Exhaustion, and the other was Cheerful Nihilism. So Literature of Exhaustion is important to know, because in that essay, he explains why the contemporary novel or drama or even poetry is parodic. It is only parodying the earlier forms. It may be historical novel, it may be an epic long poem, or it may be a lyric. They are writing parodies, not imitating the genuine form. Now, The Wasteland is a parody of a long poem with a fractured form and giving you the history of a civilization, as epics used to do, Ramayana or Mahabharata, but then very different. He said it is literature of exhaustion because all the literary forms, be it epic or novel or drama, or lyric, they stand exhausted. There have been great writers who have written, and we cannot surpass them. We can't write anything better. Therefore, what we can do is only imitate them, write parodies of them, making fun or whatever. So you have these parodies. It is literature of exhaustion. Even what Rushdie is doing, these are parodies. Second article he wrote was Cheerful Nihilism. He says, it is an age where we don't believe in anything. And human existence is absurd. That's why Theater of the Absurd, Waiting for Godot. Mm-hmm. You must have read that. So all this came because of this belief. After death of God, is a philosophy. And he says, we don't believe in anything. We are nihilists. Nihilism means believing in nothing and just having contingent life. Life from minute to minute, day to day, ad hoc. And we are not living by any faith, any belief, any set of moral values. Not what Hinduism says or common man is living from day to day, from minute to minute, and just, trying to make do and sustain his life. So cheerful nihilism means the world is absurd. The theory of the absurd in a minute was given by Camus, again a French writer, Albert Camus. And Camus' idea of the absurd was that the world is Darwinian. It has no moral purpose. But every religion, it may be Bible, it may be Quran, it may be Bhagavad Gita, they say this was created with a purpose for man, so on and so forth. All kinds of fictions are there in religions. Camus said these are fictions, man-made fictions, only to keep people together, keep people sane, keep people on the moral path and so on. Religions have great social relevance. But then he says, you can't say that all this is true. We know it is fiction, but it is necessary because people have to be kept on the right path. Otherwise, like animals, they will eat each other or kill each other. So nihilism philosophy or of the absurd is that there is no purpose in this existence on earth. As Darwin said, it is governed by two principles. One is struggle for existence. Everybody is trying to live on, preserving life, avoiding death, by any means, because you don't want to die, you want to live on. So struggle for existence. But then the larger fish eat the smaller fish. The struggle goes on. How to save yourself? Second, he says, is survival of the fittest. Those who are not fit, they get eliminated. Even species get eliminated. Dinosaur once ruled the animal species. Now it's no longer there, eliminated. So he says that is how the world goes. But Camus says the tragedy is that man is always looking for moral purpose. Whenever anything happens, we say, what kind of God, what kind of justice? He was a gentleman or she was a good girl, and yet she died or she suffered, she had this injustice. We are looking for moral purpose. He says, there is no moral purpose. It is all by accident or by, you see, power or struggle or by, you see, survival of the fittest. So there is no moral purpose. So this dichotomy between what is not there and what you are looking for. He says the human existence is immoral. Life on earth is immoral, without any moral purpose. But man is looking for moral. So this is a coexistence or confrontation of the moral and the immoral. This makes human existence absurd. Man is in an absurd situation, looking for something which is not there. That is why waiting for Godot. You are waiting for something which is not there. Godot is just a name, fictitious, for something which does not exist, just like God. He says, you may call it also D-O-G rather than G-O-D. Mm-hmm. So it is not there, but you are waiting for it. Christians are waiting for the second coming. Christ will come and everything will be all right. We also believe avatar, Krishna's avatar will come and something will happen and everything will be all right. Mm-hmm. So he says this stupid or absurd insistence of man waiting for something which is not there, this makes the situation absurd. That's why you have theater. Lot of plays written, theater of the absurd, etc. So John Barth wrote this. He says, if the situation is absurd, then why get depressed? Why get sad and sullen? Be cheerful. If life is absurd or meaningless, laugh it away. Don't be despondent, don't kill yourself. You can't commit suicide. Therefore, be cheerful. So, cheerful nihilism. And that is the mood reflected in the literature of the post-war period or post-modern. Midnight's Children, very cheerful. You read that, but believing in nothing. So, you have that kind of literature.
So, these are the things just an outlet for the emotion which you…
Of course. And literature is for that.
Yeah, and that makes you cheerful.
I was reading Kushwant Singh the other day, mm-hmm. and he said, I had not really seen partition firsthand, because he was in England at that time. Mm-hmm. But he said, all that I heard from my village people, from other people, how the whole lot of trains full of people were massacred and so on, or trains came full of dead bodies. He says, it was a burden on my mind. So I want to get a relief from that burden. Mm-hmm. So I thought I'll have it out, means write it out. So he wrote that novel, Train to Pakistan. And so literature is for that, having it out, getting relieved of what is a burden on your conscience. Similarly, Hemingway used to say, because he also participated in First World War, Second World War, and Spanish Civil War. So he was carrying a lot of things on his mind. He says, I want to get rid of them.
To what extent the author have freedom to introduce something which is not exactly happen, like in Train to Pakistan? He must have some kind of imagination and some kind of the thinking which he have inserted, which might not have happened or occurred during that time.
Well, yes, that is the difference between history and literature. Okay. Even historical novel will not be history. As Aristotle said, literature combines history and philosophy. It will give you particular stories, men, women, of joys, of suffering, good days, bad days. So all that will be there. But then you can't verify it, because the man of letters or literary writer is not writing history. He's not writing about Babur or Akbar or Nehru or Gandhi. He's writing about fictitious names. But he says the way he creates characters, the way he creates incidents, while reading them, you always feel, yes, it sounds true. I have seen such people, or it has happened to me also. So he says this is the general truth. This is the philosophic truth in literature, which keeps it relevant for all times. That's why Ramayana or Mahabharata or Iliad or Odyssey, written 3,000 years ago, we are still reading, because it has universal appeal to our emotions. It says of things, or narrates things which happen in general life to everybody.
Okay. Can character take name of the real hero in a good way, a bad way of the time?
Yeah, sure. In some cases, they use that name also. But then not many writers would do that, because it's risky.
Risky in the sense?
Risky in the sense there are people, followers or opponents of that name, and they will be at you. You know FMSN,
yeah,
or MFSN, Maqbool Fiza, yeah, Fida Hussain. His paintings burnt and he had to leave the country, because he was painting Hindu goddesses as women of a different sort.
Yeah, that is a kind of, we can say, extremist or radical people we do.
But satanic verses.
Yeah. But the author have freedom to do it. Your character.
Well, never. Author has never had complete freedom. In Shakespeare's time, those who wrote against the kings, their ears or nose were chopped. They were sent to prison. So Shakespeare does it very cleverly in the subtext, subverting the main text. And he makes the kings themselves speak and so on. You see, King Lear, when he has lost power and is like a beggar, then he's speaking truth about kings. He says, even a dog is obeyed in office. If you are holding chair, you may be a donkey, but you will be obeyed because you are a king or a prince. But if Shakespeare had said it, they would have thrown him into prison.
Right.
But he makes one of the characters say it. Or he will make his fools and jesters say things, because they will not be taken seriously.
So author have to create the character accordingly.
Yeah,
taking the
he
position
has to
of
find
that.
Very clever ways of saying things, okay, and not endangering his position, himself, his life.
Okay, so suppose in present context, what we are, because a new group of authors is coming in India, they are writing on the present political, social, economic issues, and sometimes they are tarnishing the image and all this, but still they are not, means they are getting their space, and people are tolerating, we can say, that despite being innuendo and all other things.
Of course, we do. Yeah. But then sometimes writers also stoop down. All writers are not great writers. I was reading one of the novels by Salman Rushdie, The Land Beneath Her Feet, is one of his novels. Now, in that novel, a dog is named as Nehru. Now, why do you do that? Some correspondent asked him at this Jaipur festival, why did you name the dog as Nehru? He said, no, you see, when my Satanic verses came, Rajiv Gandhi had refused to grant me visa. So, it's a sort of revenge. Now, literature is not the, you see, field for revenge.
Yeah.
Sorry, you join politics, you then say it directly. Mm. You can't say it in the novel. You don't expect such, you see, petty things or this level of writing in literature.
Yes.
It is not universal.
Creativity and integrity.
You are being rather mean.
Yeah.
Nehru at least didn't deny you visa.
Right.
It may be Rajiv Gandhi, but not Jawaharlal Nehru. So doing dirt to great people is not great writing.
So,
but these are business times. Even there is business in creating controversy. You sell better. If you write satanic verses, make something controversial, immediately the whole world gets woken up to it. They would like to read, and it pleases the West. If you are talking against Islam, they'll be very happy. Everybody will be reading in America and England satanic verses. Similarly, anything wrong, like this White Tiger by Adiga. He's sitting in Australia and writing about the dirt in India and so on. Now it pleases the Englishmen very well. They are very happy.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why none of these Indians is publishing their novels here in India. Why not? Because they are earning pounds and dollars and living there, writing about India. This is a very clever way of doing things. Why not come here and live among your own people, get things published here? But it's not very lucrative. So they want to make business and writing for the market. They know the market. So you have all kinds of writers, but after 20 years or 50 years, you don't know how many of them will survive.
Mm-hmm.
In times of Shakespeare also, there were so many writers, but how many have survived? We read Shakespeare, we don't read any other. Maybe Marlowe or Ben Jonson in the MA course, but that is all. There were 300 writers, we read only three.
Okay, so writers would remain, they should have their own boundary, they should not cross that otherwise.
Yes, yeah, you stay as writer.
Yeah.
Don't come down to the petty level of politics.
Mm-hmm. So, the last question I'd like to ask you, the three yardstick on which a student will make the that this literature is a postmodern literature, which one should have in the mind while reading the literature?
You mean poetry, drama, novel?
Yeah, anything. This is the postmodern. They can distinguish the distinct feature.
Well, distinctive features of the postmodern or the postcolonial literature are that it is unconventional. It doesn't follow the old traditional forms and attitudes. Like it will not have a linear storytelling. Past, present, future, what happened yesterday, what is happening today. So time now is simultaneous.
Mm-hmm.
Present, future, past. Read Midnight's Children and you find there is no such linear movement of the narrative. That is one aspect of postmodern literature. And other is that the writer is isolated from the people. He's an individual.
Oh.
Writing more about himself than about people.
Mm-hmm.
That is why you can easily write about India sitting in America or England or Australia. Earlier writers like Premchand or Kalidas and so on, they used to, or Kabir, they used to live among people and they used to write about people. Mm-hmm. They had a sharing of that life with them. Now today's writer has no sharing with the people and is at best writing either about himself or imagines things. That is why you have fantastic literature, magical realism. Rushdie's kind of novel is called magical realism. So it's a kind of magic lantern, not reality as it is on the ground, but what he shows. Then third is, it is more journalistic kind of writing rather than creative.
Okay. So, well, friends, we discussed the postmodern English literature. I hope that you have got the main point which we want to communicate. So I thank all of you for watching the lecture. And on your behalf, I thank Dr. Bhim Singh Dahiya for giving such an insightful lecture on this very topic. Thank you very much.
Thank you.